Bruno, let's start with the title of the new album. Why did you choose that title?
My album is called Unorthodox Jukebox because before I've written an album, I used to go and perform and play for big record executives. And that was always what they would tell me. They would always say my music's too unorthodox. And it was a hard pill to swallow because my music reflects who I am as a person. And I think I'm unorthodox, so why should my music sound like that? And I think a lot of it had to do with because they didn't know how to market it. They didn't know what radio stations to play it on. So the title Unorthodox Jukebox is kind of a statement of my freedom.
Could you explain how have you evolved as an artist from the first to the second album, and how has the sound evolved or changed?
How have I evolved as an artist? The best way I can describe it, it's over two years later. I've grown. I've toured for the first time. So I know what it feels like to play these songs live every night, and I took all of that energy and put it into this album. Everything that I learned in the past two, three years and wanting to do, I did it on this album. And hopefully that's what it's going to be like for every album. You're going to hear growth and, bringing something new to the table every time.
You've worked with different producers. Why did you choose them?
Why did I choose the producers on this album? Every single producer, I'm a big fan of their musical taste and the way they approach music. Mark Ronson, Jeff Basker, and my good friend Emil. You know, these guys, they make the music that they want to make. And I respect that, and I want to surround myself with people like that.
Mm-hmm. So people say Mark Ronson is a very stylish person, people say Bruno Mars is a very stylish person, so who's more stylish?
I'm definitely more stylish than Mark Ronson. He wishes he had my flavor. You hear me, Mark? You hear me? I'm sorry, there's a lot of sick people back there coughing. Label!
Okay, before we go and talk about music, maybe let's stick with the style. So people love your hats, so why did you choose all these hats? And do you have a huge hat collection at home? Or?
Yes, I have a lot of hats. My hair is curly, and anyone that has curly hair understands that it has a personality of its own, so it's much easier for me to just throw a hat on.
Do you know how many hats you have got?
How many hats I have?
Yeah.
Probably 8,546, I think. 47, I just bought one today.
Wow. And this is your favorite one?
This is my favorite one. And my sombrero. But I'll stick with this one.
So if people think about your home country, Hawaii, they think, at least in Germany, about these shirts with the flowers, you know what I mean. But you've got a very good style. Do you hate these shirts?
Aloha shirts? No, I love Aloha shirts. They're cool. I have a few of my own.
But who inspired your style?
Who inspired my style? I don't know. I guess I see something that I like and I have to have it.
Is it maybe like old stars or the old actors?
Hold on. Come in, David, and close the fucking door.
That's the second time.
You're worse every time.
That's the second
time, right?
Sorry.
No problem.
Okay, maybe once again. So who inspired your style? Maybe old actors like Sinatra and all these old guys?
Who inspired my style? Yeah, I always look back at the guys, you know, old Hollywood maybe. I love the way they dressed back then.
Right. So let's talk about the single. So could you tell me a bit, Locked Out of Heaven, what inspired that song? What is it about? Could you explain it a bit?
Locked Out of Heaven?
Yeah.
Locked Out of Heaven is about a woman giving you something you've never felt before. That's the long answer. You want the short answer?
Yeah, why not?
It's about sex.
Right. Okay, I guess when you listen to the new songs, the topics have changed a bit. You've mentioned sex. I mean, this is in some songs. So did you want to go in a more edgier direction, let's call it, or?
With this album, it was, the first album, I have Just the Way You Are and Grenade, songs that I've written that I love and that I'm going to be performing forever. But I already wrote those songs. I want to write new songs, talk about new things. So I pushed myself to, you know, venture off and experiment with different lyrical content.
What about Gorilla? I mean, some people might be shocked to hear that song for the first time, I guess, so.
Gorilla was actually the first song we wrote for this album, and it really set the bar. Just reminded us that there's no boundaries, there's no laws. We can do whatever we want. This is why we signed up to do music, and it really became kind of the mascot song of this album. That's why we put a gorilla on the cover. And if it shocks people, you know, that's good. Everything can't be safe and sweet, and you're supposed to feel something when you hear music.
So do you like to be unpredictable in a way?
Do I like to be? I don't know. I just hope that, like I said, I hope that you could just hear change. Every album I put out, I want the fans and the audience to grow with me and change with me.
Yeah. So would you say this is more a grown-up album or an album for grown-up people?
This album is for whoever wants to listen to it. It doesn't matter how old you are, where you're from. It's for people that that will hopefully enjoy it.
Mm-hmm. And we hear some very explicit words, the so-called F words, as we say in German. So
fuck.
Yeah, right. Have you thought, can I really put these words into songs or?
Yeah, it's you know, you write songs and sometimes I pick up a guitar and I'll freestyle. And sometimes, you know, a love song will come out and sometimes profanity will come out. But whatever it is that comes out is, it's my art and it's my expression. So I don't want to have to change it because it won't get played on the radio or for whatever reasons or politics reasons. I don't want to dilute my music because of business. So if I want to say the word fuck, I'm gonna say it.
Right, but there is one ballad on the album as well. Is this for the girls, or why did you decide to put one ballad on it?
When I Was Your Man, you're talking about?
Yeah.
When I Was Your Man, it was just a song I think the purest form of music is piano and a vocal. Why you gotta do this here? Why you gotta do this here? When I Was Your Man, I feel like the most important thing is the purest form of music is piano and a vocal. And that's what I wanted to do. I've never done it on my last album, and I wanted to do it on this one. And it's just me and the piano and the truth, the sad, sad truth.
So
here's to you, track number 6.
Thank you. So was there really a moment in your life when you felt like what you described in that song, when you had this regret that the girl left? And
was there a moment in my life? No,
yeah.
It's all lies. It's all fabricated lies to sell records. Yes, it's the truth. And it's the moment, of course. I have to write what I feel. I definitely felt I've experienced this before, and I wrote about it.
So your lyrics are always autobiographical, or do you sometimes make some stories up?
It depends. You know, sometimes I can let my imagination run wild, but I think it always has to come from a pure place of truth, of something that you know.
And I heard that you like Jimi Hendrix very much, so can we expect a real rock album in the future?
Yeah, maybe. Jimi Hendrix is my favorite. You never know. I don't know. It depends. You know, it depends where I am and how I feel. I might come out with a country album. I might start rapping. I might start rapping on a country song.
But what do you admire about Jimi Hendrix? Tell me.
What?
What do you admire about Jimi
Hendrix? What do I admire about Jimi Hendrix?
Yeah.
I mean, individuality and fearless, not being scared, right? Doing the music that he wanted to do, you could tell, you know? I mean, and first, it's God-given talent of playing the guitar like no one has ever played it before till this day. And great songwriter, and I loved his voice.
If you could spend a day with Jimi Hendrix, what would you like to do with him? If it would be possible.
If I could spend a day with Jimi Hendrix, what would I like to do with him?
Yeah.
I'd like to be in the studio with him and just be a fly on the wall and just kind of watch how they used to do it back then.
So would you like to have a time machine, go back to another period? Watch older musicians you admire, maybe?
Yeah, who doesn't want a time machine? Do you want a time machine?
Well, yeah, maybe.
What maybe?
Maybe I'm a bit scared.
I'd take a time machine.
Yeah. Would you like to meet Elvis?
Sure.
If you could choose someone you could work with, who would it be?
Just a moment. There's a mobile. Some mobile is on. You can hear it.
Mine?
You have one?
Is it ringing?
What do you hear?
Maybe just put it right next to the microphone.
Dribble.
Thank you.
Better?
Yes.
Sorry.
No problem.
It's okay.
Thanks.
Still running?
Okay, so is there anybody you would like to work with my question?
Yeah. If I could. That would be nice to work with some of my idols, but it's also nice that they're my idols, and you know, I have an imagination of what kind of people they are.
Mm-hmm. Nowadays, people love to have guest musicians on their albums. So on your album, there's nobody. Why?
There's no one on my album because I just kind of locked myself in the studio until it was finished. You know, the last album I had some features on it, but it was because it happened so organic. I was working with B.O.B., CeeLo at the time, and you know, they were in the studio. I was like, hey guys, get on my album. And you know, this one was a different story. It was just kind of, like I said, I didn't leave until everything was finished.
Could you tell me which song will be the second single?
Which song will be the second single? I think Young Girls.
Why that one?
Because I want it to be the second single. I feel I felt good when I wrote it. I felt like I wrote a strong song about something that I wanted to talk about. And I love the song.
Mm-hmm. Who produced that one?
We produced that one, the Smeezingtons and Jeff Basker and Emil Haney.
So maybe let's go back to the ballad. I've asked you about the ballad and you said, well, it's a breakup song. I asked myself, why did you write such a sad song? I mean, you were in a happy relationship, so where did that come from?
I've been in situations where, you know, everything's not so, where I messed up on this song. You know, I'm basically just admitting that. And definitely easier to sing about than to talk about. And if you want to hear what I'm talking about, maybe listen to the song.
Mm-hmm. On your last album was a song, Marry You, and I think a lot of people have used that song to ask their partner to marry them. Yeah. What was it like for you?
It's really cool to see people use that song, Marry You. It's like, you know, and it becoming like a soundtrack in people's lives and using it to propose to their girlfriends, and it's very flattering. It's surreal because it's such a silly song that we're kind of just joking around in the studio talking about getting drunk and getting married in like a Vegas scenario, and you know, it's a good time, and I think people, I'm glad it put a smile on some people's faces.
Is that something you would like, going to Vegas, getting married in Vegas, or are you more the one who dreams of a real romantic marriage?
I don't know what kind of marriage I would want. Probably somewhere on top of a mountain.
Yeah. And would you like to have a family sooner or later? Is this on your plan or?
Yeah, as soon as I could be a good family man, I'll have a family. It's hard to think about family when you're traveling everywhere. You know, I would like to be there when watch my children grow up.
So what was it like since you released your first album? Was it just working for you? No time for anything else? What have you been doing since you released the first
album? After I released the first album, I was introduced to a new life. Being on TV and performing these songs on TV and I've never done anything like that before. So I had to get used to it. You know, I come from singing in bars and just kind of jamming with my family and friends. And it was a whole new form of entertainment that I kind of had to get used to.
Do you enjoy this new form of entertainment, or was it hard for you to adapt to it in a way?
No, I love it. It's like, you know, it's your dream. You just never really know. You never really know until you're there. On really how it goes, and you know, it's a learning process.
Mm. So you've earned a bit of money now with your music. What was the first thing you bought when you earned some money with your first album? Was there anything in particular you
bought? The first thing I bought when I made a little bit of doughski was I bought my mom a house.
On Hawaii, or?
In Hawaii, yeah.
Do you still feel very close to Hawaii? Is it still your home, or do you nowadays feel at home in LA? What is it like for you? Where do you feel at home?
You know, I've lived in LA for a while now, but Hawaii is always going to be home. You know, that's everything. That's my everything down there.
Mm-hmm. What was your childhood like? Were you one of these surfer guys who loved to surf the whole day?
Or my childhood?
Yeah, you know, what do you imagine?
It was very involved with music. I was doing music since I was 4 years old in my father's show. So all my friends would be, you know, and when I was older, playing basketball or surfing, and I'd be clocking in at work.
So was your dad the one who introduced you really to music?
Yeah, my mom and my dad.
Mm-hmm. To what type of music did you listen at home? Did they have a huge record collection or?
I used to listen to, my dad was really into 1950s rock and roll and doo-wop music from that era, and also Motown and a lot of the 60s and 70s soul, and that's kind of what I used to listen to.
Mm-hmm. And then you decided to leave Hawaii to start your career or to go for your musical career, or what was it like?
When I left Hawaii when I was like 17, 18, I needed to give it a shot, I needed to try. I wanted to make my own album one day. That was my dream, and be able to see the world singing my tunes.
Did you ever have a plan D? Plan B? Sorry, plan
D. D. Wow. life's fucked if you got a plan D.
Totally. Plan B, or did you always believe, well, I'm gonna make it? I know it.
As far as music is concerned, there was never a plan B. If I wasn't doing it at the level of, being able to make my own album, I'd be doing music somewhere. I'd be singing at a restaurant, or that's all I know, thanks to my parents. You know, it's all I know how to do.
Do you remember what you felt when you heard one of your songs for the first time on the radio?
When I heard my song on the radio for the first time, yeah, I was freaking out. I felt like a little kid. It's in shock. You know, you work so hard and you go through all the ups and downs trying to finally get it there, and then that was definitely the payoff. It was nothing on you, I heard on the radio.
Yeah, right. So you mentioned that you bought a house for your mom. What did you buy for yourself? Maybe a fancy car or something like that? Or are you not very much into cars?
What did I buy for myself? I got me a car. Always wanted a Cadillac, and I got one. Power windows, AM, FM, radio.
So you are a huge car fan?
I'm not a big car collector. My dad always had a Cadillac, an old bus, you know, he always had busted up Cadillacs. And he said, son, this is when you know you're doing something big. It's when you're driving around in these things. So I guess it was always in my mind that that was the dream, is to one day own a Cadillac.
Yeah, so it was very special when you bought the first one and drove around.
Oh yeah, especially when I traded in the bucket I was driving.
So people might ask themselves, what does Bruno do when he doesn't make music? Do you have any other interests?
What do I do when I don't make music? A cage fight? I'll be in the octagon very soon, just training. Me and my friend Dre back there. You good though? What do? You know what I love to do that I don't get a chance to do that much anymore? Is go to the movies. It's my favorite thing to do. It's not that exciting, I know, but it's the truth. I love sitting in the back and watching a flick.
And a lot of musicians think about starting an active career themselves. Is this something that's on your map? Could you imagine to do some acting, make a film sooner or later?
I don't know. Right now, I'll leave that to the pros as far as acting goes. You never know, though. You know, everything the way everything's been working out with me is it's always happened so organically. So if the right thing came along where I felt I needed to do it, and I could do it, or really wanted to do it, I'll take a stab at it.
So are you someone who doesn't like to make plans for the future?
I have my certain plans and goals for the future, but it's as of now, it's really focused on music and this album.
Excuse me.
That's pleasant.
Okay. All right.
Thank you.
So, can we expect you to come on a tour with your new album?
Yes.
And if yes, what can we expect from your new show?
From the new show, that's going to be the exciting part. That's the payoff of this whole thing, is being able to work really hard in the studio and then finally perform it live. And I think with this album is going to be a spectacle. I think it's going to be a lot of fun. And powerful. It's going to be a powerful show.
Do you have a close relationship with your fans?
Do I have a close relationship with my fans? Absolutely. I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for them. And there's some fans out there that have been supporting me for the longest time. I owe it all to them.
But what is it like when the girls see you nowadays? Do they start screaming or?
No.
No? It's not like that?
Not like that.
Never?
No.
But they write you love letters, I guess, or don't they?
I've gotten some great, some fans have definitely written me some letters that really cheer me up when I'm down, say some awesome stuff. And with social media and stuff, sometimes they say some sweet things on Twitter or Facebook.
Mm-hmm. Do you like this, Twittering and Facebook and getting in touch directly with your fans?
Yeah, I do. I love being able to talk to them at any time I want and being able to just say whatever it is I want to say.
Mm-hmm. So I think nowadays the girls are crazy for you, but what was it like when you were at school? Were you the guy every girl wanted to date or?
What was I in high school? I was a hooligan. I was a troublemaker.
Really?
Yeah.
What did you do?
Just not listen. That's all. Nothing too terrible. But me and homework never really got along.
No, you didn't like homework and learning from school.
And waking up early.
To make your homework.
What's that?
No, you stood up. You got up early to make your homework before yeah. School, or what was it like?
Yeah, exactly.
Mm-hmm. Did you like to party as a teenager, or?
Yeah, of course. That's what you're supposed to do when you're a teenager. You're supposed to have fun and party.
Was it like nowadays? Are you happy when you can't stay at home because you have to work so much? Do you prefer an evening in?
Yeah, I love being at home now because, you know, you want to take advantage as much time as that as possible. because you're always in the studio and you're always doing a show. But even when I'm at home, I'm still working. I'm still thinking about a song or I have ideas.
So are you a workaholic?
Yeah, I guess you can call it a workaholic. It's not, but it's just, that's the blessing and the curse, is that sometimes, you know, you can't turn your mind off because you're trying to finish a song, or you know, you got these ideas that you really want to make sure that you capture.
But what is it like when you write a song? Comes the music first or the lyrics? What inspired what? What is it?
What inspires what? That's the unorthodox part. You never know what's going to jumpstart a song. It could be chords, it could be a melody, it could be a phrase, something that you say that makes you, you know, that rings in your head. It's you never know how it's going to come at you or what day it's going to come at you. You just hope that you're ready to capture it.
But is songwriting a bit like therapy, getting out all this stuff?
Sure, yeah, you could definitely use songwriting as therapy. Like I said, it's easier for me to sing about it than talk about it for some reason. So quite a few songs that I've written have been just my, you know, some confessions.
And people were surprised when they heard them, or?
Yeah.
So what about this song? I think it's called Natalie. Did you send that song to Natalie?
See, Natalie, that's a perfect situation to explain, you know, how an idea can start and then your imagination can run wild. You know, being a songwriter, you have to be somewhat of a storyteller. And that's a song that, that's a song where I kind of let my imagination run wild.
But what is it like in general? Do you have met?
Wunderbar, wunderbar.
Wunderbar, yeah, we come to the end. No. What is it like when you write songs? Do you have a kind of book where you write down ideas and then you say, well, now it's time to make a new song? Or is it more like, well, now I've got an idea, now I make a song? Very spontaneously. In a way.
Yeah, it's spontaneous. Sometimes I can write it down. Sometimes I'll pick up my phone and try to record it. I'll call someone up and sing it for them. I wish I had a system, and but you know, you just never know. You could be on a plane, you could be in the bathroom. It doesn't matter where it comes.
Maybe at last one question: which song on the new album is your personal favorite, and why?
Personal favorite song on the album. It's a hard question because every song is a. You know, it takes me to a special place when we wrote it, and that feeling you get in the studio when you're so excited. But I would say a special song for me on this album is I love Moonshine. That was a fun night, and that was me working with the guys that I've always wanted to work with, and I got them in a room together somehow, and it reminded me of what I signed up to do and make music and have fun and be excited about creating music. And when I worked with Mark and Jeff and my boys, and we're all in the room trying to come up with this song, you know, the final product is Moonshine. And it's a good memory for me.
All right, and now I've